Yeah, hi, my name is Mike Seitz. I've lived in this area all my life, born and raised in Tendola. Went to Hardin Northern, graduated in 1968. Played a little football and basketball here. And in 1969, I joined the Air Force. It was probably either that or get drafted, as they had to draft back then. So I thought I'd like to go in the Air Force, and always wanted to hopefully get to travel. So I joined the Air Force in 69. Went to Lackland Air Force Base in Texas for my basic training. Well, my first memories when we went to basic training in Lackland, we got there something like midnight or 1 a.m, and people were coming in all night, and at about 5 a.m., the drill sergeant came in and started screaming, "Get up." I'm like, what did I get myself into here? But it worked out. The drill sergeants down there would basically, the first few weeks, they would scare you to death and threaten you, but they couldn't do anything, but they'd just scream a lot. And then toward the end of basic, you got to see where they weren't too bad of guys and actually get you all in a huddle. And we're out doing marching or something, they'd call everybody in, and one guy used to like tell us jokes. So most of them were pretty good. Some of them were still sort of scary, but wasn't bad. And from there, I went to Shepherd Air Force Base for my technical training. I didn't know what I wanted to do when I went in. They had tests you took in four different areas, and I scored highest in mechanical. So they said go in there, and then when you go down there, when you're in basic, they take you and show you different things, like in mechanical area, like jet engine mechanic, different things. And I still didn't know what I wanted to do. So as I was watching those movies, I thought, well, jet engine mechanic, I might good. And then they showed this guy loading an airplane, and they said, that's ground crew. They load it. And the guy standing up there is the loadmaster. He's supervised. I thought, well, that'd be a good job. So I was fortunate enough, myself and one other guy from our squadron got that. And it required taking a math test, so we had to do a lot of math. And it turned out to be a really good job, but sometimes it was hectic trying to load the planes. We carried 10 pallets on our plane, and you basically had to figure out how to put 60% of the weight forward, 40% aft of the center line, and then you also had to, on the pallets, some of them would go to one base, some another, so you had to decide which one would go in front that got off last. And we carried many different things on our aircraft. We carried people sometimes. Sometimes we carried a basic food. I remember going to Greenland. We was pushing a load off and looked at the, and we were slamming it in and looked at it and said eggs. So I'm not sure if they got scrambled or not. But we carried that. We carried Aerovac, which was a military wounded out of Vietnam. Sometimes we carried caskets. And that was sort of weird to do. Carry them. At that time, they didn't put flags on like they do now, which is great, but we carried them, and that was the first thing you put on, and if you had to jettison everything, it was the last thing you threw out, so luckily we didn't have to do that. From there, after I graduated from there, in about May of 69, I was stationed at my first base, was McGuire Air Force Base in New Jersey, and there I flew on C-141 aircraft. And we flew all over the world, so very interesting job, a lot of responsibilities. But I got to see, I was in like 13 different foreign countries there. We would fly basically some trips were called sea trips, Southeast Asia. We would fly from McGuire Air Force Base to Elmendorf Air Force Base in Alaska, which took about 8 hours, and then you would crew rest for 12 hours, and then planes were coming and going, so you picked up the next plane, that crew got off, you got on, flew from there to Yokota, Japan, did the same thing from there to usually Vietnam, and then usually back to Okinawa, back to Elmendorf, back home to McGuire, which took about 6 days, so a lot of traveling. Also got to fly to Europe, spend some time over there, Turkey, island of Crete. I was in Spain, in Madrid, Germany, England. Went to Stopped in Iceland once. Went used to take a trip. We had a trip out of New Jersey. It was a 24-hour trip. It went to Thule, Greenland, so it was near the North Pole. Stopped at a couple bases up there and took supplies and then come back home. And in May of 70, I got my orders to go overseas. So I was ordered to go to a place called Nakhon Phnom, Thailand, which I had no idea where that was. In the meantime, in that summer, I went to Lockbourne Air Force Base, which is now Rickenbacker, take training on a C-123 aircraft, which I was going to be on. And then in that summer, we also was sent to Fairchild Air Force Base for 2 weeks, which is in Washington near Spokane. And we did survival training there, which was very interesting, to say the least. And then I shipped out on 12th of September for overseas. We stopped in the Philippines for about 2 weeks, where we had to do jungle survival school. So we got to stay in the jungle a couple nights, which was sort of scary. you made yourself a hammock up in the trees about 4 foot off the ground and slept there on it. And when it gets dark, it gets really dark in the jungle. And of course, before we went, they showed us their little zoo they had, which the animals they captured in the jungle, which were poisonous snakes, things like boas, and then some rats, which were like this big. So as you're laying there at night sleeping and hearing these strange noises, you're hoping that a snake's not coming down the tree or going to eat you or anything. So I spent a week or two there, and I went to Nakhon Phnom, Thailand. And it was odd when I flew into that base, being on jets on C-141s in New Jersey. When I flew into the base, as I landed, I looked around, and all I could see was prop planes and like World War II planes. And there weren't any jets there. It was all C-123s, C-119, which was a flying boxcar. They used that as a gunship. A C-47, which they used as a gunship. Some A-1E Sandies, they called them Sandies. They were World War II. Fighter-type plane they used for search and rescue. So that was rather odd landing there, but it was basically a secret base, because when we come in there, they told us don't take pictures and don't tell where you're at. Air Force and Thai Air Force, and they closed the base probably about 75, 78. Now it's all, the only thing there now is a runway and a terminal for the use of civilian. The rest of it's all grown up back into jungle. On duties there, on the C-123, we carried flares, so we would flare a base at night. We carried 100 flares, which were about 4 foot tall, and they would burn for 3 minutes, so we were in a circle pattern. We would fly, and so every 3 minutes, we would throw out 2 flares, and they would light up the ground. They were like 3 million candle power each. They could come down on a parachute, so we would do that for bases so they wouldn't get attacked. As far as flying over there in Thailand, when we flew, I flew on the C-123s. We flew over Laos all the time. We didn't fly or flew occasionally into Vietnam. Our missions were all night missions. We had 100 flares and some markers, so we would flare the bases in Thailand Laos, excuse me, mostly up in northern Laos around the Plain of Jars. We flare the Laotian bases, and also there were CIA bases up there. Of course, no one knew about this back then. It was because it was called the Secret War. And our base, we weren't allowed to tell anybody what we do. We had to fly without any insignia on our flight suits, or we couldn't carry anything except maps and survival gear, things like that. But we didn't carry anything that identified us. And there's a lot of CIA in that area working out of our base and other bases in Thailand that would go up and fly planes into some of the Laotian bases, take supplies, different things like that. But like I said, it was a secret war, so nobody knew about it for lots of years after. We had the northern part of Laos was called the Barrel Roll, and the southern part was called the Steel Tiger. And we would fly through those areas. We had 2 starlight scopes on our aircraft, one in the belly and one in the left trandor, which the navigators looked through there. We flew it around 13,000 feet. And you could see on the ground, it was sort of like the night vision glasses they have now, but a lot more powerful back then as far as height-wise. And so we could see on the ground trucks going down the Ho Chi Minh Trail, and we would drop our markers, and then we'd try to call in fighter planes, usually from the Air Force or from the Navy, and they would come in, and the navigators would give them directions off the markers where to hit. And so we did that, and of course the Lowmasters, we sat in the back, we had windows on both sides of the plane and back. Our job was to look for gunfire, and we got shot at regularly with some pretty big guns that they use, anti-aircraft guns. There was 37 millimeters, 57 millimeters. Never saw any 100 shot at us, but there were SAM, surface-to-air missiles, and along the trail, and also occasionally a MiG would come through, which was rather frightening to us, but we only had that a couple times. But that's what we did over there. Which, like I say, nobody back home knew we were using, we were flying in those areas. Even my mother, she thought I was mostly flying cargo missions in Thailand until they sent the award home, where we got awarded the Distinguished Flying Cross. And of course it said in there that we were under heavy fire and hostile area, which sort of frightened her. But of course when you're in the military, you don't tell your parents everything you do while you're in there, sort of, so they can sleep at night, basically. But that's what we did over there. It's interesting flying. We also threw out leaflets. We had, one of my jobs over there was to load leaflets on some of the planes, and they were basically propaganda leaflets telling the Vietnamese or whoever on the ground to surrender and things like that. So we'd throw out, we'd probably load 40 boxes on there, throw them out at night, and they'd scatter all over the world. And but that's what we did over there. It was pretty interesting flying. Occasionally we'd fly into Vietnam for cargo missions or something like that, but not very often. But this is what we did at Thailand. And there were five or six bases in Thailand during the Vietnam War, and all of them supported the people in Vietnam. So they were all awarded. If you flew over Vietnam, if you were in combat missions, then you were awarded the campaign medal. If you were just on the ground and didn't get to fly, then you weren't awarded the Vietnam campaign medal. So some of them weren't awarded, some were. But I flew about a little over 90 missions over there, and almost 500 combat hours. And left there, and our squadron shut down. They were sort of phasing everything out. In 71, in July, they closed down our squadron, so I got to come home about a month and a half early. From there, I went to Langley Air Force Base in Virginia, where I flew on C-130s. I was in Aerial Port Squadron there. And what we did there was we rigged loads for airdrop, packed parachutes, things like that, cargo chutes, which were, the cargo chutes were 100 foot in diameter. And the bag they were in, and once they got them packed, they were just about 4 foot tall. And we would pack those, put them on the drops, and then we go out and do airdrops, things like that. Touch them, come back and do what they called touch and go. So the aircraft had hit the runway, take back off, not stop, just round and round we went, which wasn't much fun. But so it didn't really travel a whole lot there. A few missions we went on to Panama, things like that. But all in all, it was very interesting. I was glad I got to be a loadmaster. I wanted to go back on 141s, but the Air Force didn't see to that, so I finally got out in 1973. And sometimes when I was in New Jersey, I would call. I got to come home. I didn't come home much. Sometimes in New Jersey, when I flew out of there, for every 3 days out, they gave us 1 day off when we got back. So I would talk to the first sergeant. Sometimes he let me come home for a couple days. I'd usually fly from Philadelphia into Toledo. My parents come pick me up and come home for a couple days and fly back. Overseas, just by letters, which usually took about 6 days to get back. We had what they call a Mars system, but I never used it, but you could call, it's like a shortwave radio. And sometimes you could call that way. Food in the Air Force was pretty good, actually. Yeah, it's one of the better foods. Yeah, it was good. We had chow halls. Overseas, we had chow halls. It was funny. I got to be friends with some of the guys in the chow hall. So I would take them, take parachutes out of our flares, which were like 12-foot parachutes because they wanted a parachute. So we'd take one of them out and give it to them, and they'd give us sheet cakes or things like that. So I'd go to the airplane with a big sheet cake, and everybody's like, hey, where'd you get that? So we did pretty well. Well, I had a lot of buddies over there. Some of them, most of the time, once you leave basic, if you don't get their name and number, which we didn't back in, it was very hard to contact them. There was two other guys I stationed with pretty much all 4 years. One was from New Jersey and one was from Connecticut. We were stationed at New Jersey together. And we both went, all three of us went overseas. They went to Vietnam, I went to Thailand, and then we come back to Langley Field. We were all stationed at the same base, and we lived in an apartment together down there. But a lot of guys you never get to see again unless you happen to run into them at a base. So we didn't really, it's not like today where you can get on Facebook and find somebody. I mean, I have lately found some guys I stationed with, but that was 50 years ago, so a lot of them have passed away. So, we just didn't stay in contact very well back then. It was funny because that in New Jersey, well, I used to go down to the movies, different things like that. And I lived off, actually, I was fortunate enough to live off base there also. My uncle had a trailer. So I asked my first sergeant if I could stay in a trailer, which is about 5 miles off base. And he said, as long as you keep your bed made at the base, you can do that. So we'd go down, go to movies, just go try to find football games to go to and different things. Overseas, we had in our, what they call our hooch, we had a, it was like a long barracks, and we had a day thing in the middle. So guys would, especially on payday, they'd play blackjack. And the game might go on for 2 or 3 days. Because we flew at night. We had a helicopter squadron next door. They flew in the daytime, so somebody's always there playing blackjack. And I never played because I didn't want to lose my money. I knew guys that did play in first of the month, and they wouldn't have any money the rest of the month, so they want to come around and borrow money. But that, and we went, and Tyler and I got to be friends. We had what we call house girls. They'd come and shine our shoes, clean our rooms for us for a very small amount of money, maybe $4 or $5 a month is all they made, which was a lot over there, but they got like 4 guys to pay them, and they had several rooms. So they actually did pretty well. I got to be friends with them, and on sometimes on my days off and their days off, I would tell them I would rent a taxi, and we'd travel throughout the countryside. I wanted them to show me different things around Thailand. We'd go to different Buddhist temples and just different places around Thailand. So it was very interesting. Okay, well, some of the things we had to do at our base, we're fortunate it was a pretty well-developed base. Thailand. We actually had a base. We had a gym. We had bowling alley. And we had an outdoor theater. And, of course, we had USO, airmen's clubs, things like that. So, you know, there's a lot of things to do on base. I also got to play. I played basketball with our squadron and softball with our squadron. I'm thinking we played some flag football, but that might have been at another base. I can't really remember that. But another thing we did at our squadron, we would go down off base. There was a school a few miles from our base, a Thai school, and we would go down and do things down at the base, help build buildings for them, and always, every time we went, we took the kids candy and things like that to pass out and gum. So they enjoyed that, and we enjoyed it too. And I think even to this day, there's a group called the Thailand, Laos, Cambodia veterans, and they're still helping out with those schools over there. So probably being away from home. First, it's sort of hard being away from home. Sometimes you get used to it. It wasn't too bad. I mean, it overseas, you knew you was going to be there for a year, so just sort of had to accept that fact. But it was, you know, that's probably the hardest thing is that. And when you lose friends, had a good friend of mine that I went to school with at Lockbourne. When I went to Thailand, I flew into Vietnam to Da Nang one time, ran into a friend of mine, told me at one of the guys we went to school with was killed earlier that year in a plane crash and killed everybody on board. So he was about 20. That was probably the hardest thing.
What was it like coming back home?
Well, coming back home from Thailand was a little bit different. When I came home, I had 6 days to get ready. They told us, or they were shutting our squadron down. They told us that about, probably about April. And then we didn't know when. When they told us, we had basically about 5 or 6 days to get ready to ship out. So I couldn't really send a letter to my parents because I wouldn't have got there until I'd already been home. So we shipped out, we got home, I flew into San Francisco and booked a flight, tried to book a flight to Columbus. Most of the time coming home in Vietnam, people didn't want to talk to you. They shunned you quite a bit because you were in Vietnam, and at that time being in the military wasn't a real good thing. And so I flew home, made it home, I'd probably up at least 24 hours because you're all excited about coming home. You can't sleep. So come home. I didn't have any real bad experiences, but just a lot of people. I had some friends in college. I'd go with them, and people just, they didn't want to talk about it. They didn't want to ask you any questions, and they didn't really care about it. So sort of just kept to yourself. I met my wife in Virginia when I was at Langley Field, and she worked at McDonald's, and that's where I ate a lot, so that's where we met. We got married, and we lived here all our lives. I have two kids. It's Todd, because my daughter, who lives in Cincinnati, she works for the government, Department of Energy, and my son, he lives in D.C., and he works for Department of Defense. He works for the Navy, so he has a good job there, and he likes it. My wife passed away a couple years ago, and my parents lived here, and of course they're gone now, but I have a brother and sister live around, and some nieces and nephews and great nephews that go to Hardin Northern. So I come out and watch their games and things like that. So, but yeah, I've lived around here all my life, and it's not a bad place to live. There's a book out now. It's been out for a while with a guy I flew with in Vietnam, or in Thailand. He was a pilot, and it's called Flying Through Midnight. And it's about one of the missions that he was on. I wasn't on that mission. I knew the guys that were on it. Very interesting book. They flew up to Laos, which is where we flew, and they actually had to land at night in a base. And so we thought we lost them because everybody's usually home by midnight or after four. Our missions were 4 hours. So they didn't come home at night, so we had thought we lost them, but next morning here they came. So it's a very interesting book. I have a couple copies of it, and it's about a flight. Yeah, about, like I say, I wasn't on the flight, but I do know the guys that were on it. And I actually contacted the pilot, and after he got out, he flew for one of the major airlines, and he's written a couple books. Well, of course, now the military's changed a lot from when I was in. It's a good place to go anymore if you want that kind of life, and you know, they have a lot of benefits. They'll pay for your college, different things like that. Sometimes you get to travel and see the world, which I always said if they're going to pay to send me those places, I'd enjoy going. And I tell my son the same thing since he works for the Navy. They send him all over the world, so I said as long as they're paying for it, go, because it didn't cost you anything. Being in the military, you meet some good friends, and you know, you try to stay in touch. But if you don't, there's still a lot of other military around here that I meet with about every week, and we have breakfast and hash old times, and so there's a lot of veterans, and I try to help out veterans whenever I can. If they need anything, I'm in the VFW at Dunkirk, and we try to do what we can for not only the veterans, but for the school or different things like that. Being in the military, like I say now, it's a lot different now, and so I can't really speak to how it is in there now, because since it is all volunteer, but they do train you, they teach you a lot, and you learn a lot of things in there.